over again. So let us see that these are the three circles. As it was told by Dr. Swaroop, that there is an environment health, there is animal health, human health, and one health is encompassing everything. So this is the connectivity, and this connectivity cannot be broken. If you look at one health, then there is a look at the lower picture part. There is individual health, population health, ecosystem, which is supported by all kinds of the science, veterinary medicine, human medicine, molecular biotechnology, ecology, health genomics. And then you see here that there are a lot of infections and other things like bacterial infection, viral infection, vector-borne infection, antimicrobial resistance, parasitic infections, and then there are zoonotic infections over in this thing. And this all leads to comparative medicine and translation medicine, because all these sciences have to be dealt together. And this impinges into metabolic disorders for animal and humans, joint and skeletal diseases, cancer and cardiovascular diseases, environmental diseases, and human and animal health. When I show you this picture, I am in the board of the Tata Memorial Center, for 18 years I was chair of the Research Council of ATRAC. So one day Dr. Badve says that I'm going to open a cancer hospital for dogs. I said, what? He said, every disease which we have and every cancer we have, dogs have the same thing. So while treating the dogs, we will learn what's happening in the humans. So that particular thing rang as a bell. It is not only infections, it's many other conditions which we share together. So there is a common thread between all of us. So if I go to the next slide, if we really look at these are the major infectious disease outbreaks in Southeast Asia. And all the list is there. Ebola, Crimean Congo hemorrhagic fever. This I'm not presenting today, but we had an outbreak, and it is there in the Gujarat, Vidarbha, and contiguous Pakistan region. This is there. Influenza H5N1 was one of the first which hit us. Lassa fever, monkeypox, this happens in India. Nipah, this I had to also handle in the Siliguri, Nadia district, as well as the Bangladesh. The Rift Valley fever, there is a variant of this in India. Klusenfeld-Jakob disease, this also is relevant in India. Two of my relatives got this. I handled this. There was an equivalent of Venezuelan equine encephalomyelitis, which actually got our racehorses. The yellow fever, which we do not have, but we have a lot of flaviviruses. West Nile virus, we have cryptosporidiosis, we have from the cattle to calf to human. Leptospirosis, we have in plenty. The Escherichia coli 0157, we have lesser than the West because our cattle feed is different. The multi-drug resistant Salmonella, we have rampant, both Typhimurium as well as Salmonella typhi. Plague, I talked about to you just now. What happened? Why isn't it? So this is the list for zoonotic influenza, Salmonella, West Nile, plague, emerging coronavirus, rabies. We are one of the largest country after South Africa, which have the largest number of rabies, brucellosis, Lyme disease. And everything starts from the deforestation. Then illegal and poorly regulated wildlife. China, that's why these all start from China, because the proximity between animals and humans are decreasing. The space is becoming very close together. And this is the space where we are at the moment living. So intensified agriculture, livestock production, and others, particularly the free-ranging ones in India, is very, very, and the climate change is in the root of all of this. Less water, drought, flood, and all of these things. So this is a very complex arena. And greatest burden of zoonosis falls on billion poor livestock keepers. So there's a cause of 2 to 3 billion human illnesses and also 1.7 million human deaths a year, apart from the making farmers very, very poor. And you see, India is absolutely black in this area. The same thing, if we really look at this heat map, where the yellow and the red areas are visible over here, the red areas are the areas which are dangerous areas for many of the zoonotic diseases. And so there's a, wherever there's a mammalian host or mammalian reservoir overlapping with human, this is the heat map which is there. Some of the areas are much more affected than India in this particular arena. So if we really look at that, how these are, this is the fifth, there's a group of scientists in India which sat and prioritized these diseases. So these were the diseases which were prioritized. Rabies was one of them. Then the brucellosis was one of them. So if you really look at this, every major infection is over here. The foodborne diseases, which also come from animals, also figures over here. Plague is at the lowest point because it doesn't happen so often in India. And if you really see this area, like many of them comes from the bats. Bats have a very peculiar temperature profiling, and bats also have something which is cyclical. And so sometimes bats transmit to human, or sometimes it goes through, like old SARS was from the civet. This one, people think pangolin, because this one got Nipah right from the bat in India, but in the pig, through pigs in the Malaysia. So Middle East respiratory syncytial virus is from the camel. The COVID-19, as I told you, for us bats and pangolin, and avian flu from the wild bird to poultry, and swine flu from the pigs to human, and now human to human. And they go, most of them go all around. Only African one, the Ebola remained in Africa, but yellow fever, recently 13 Chinese got yellow fever. They didn't take vaccination, of course, but flaviviruses have become a very important part in our world. So if we really look at the timeline for this COVID activity, we see that there are huge amount of different timeline in the different countries, but the way they actually handled it. And this heat map shows that how many days they took to reach those particular places, that infection diagnostics, vaccine activities, the PPEs, all of these are in this particular chart. I will not take too much time, but you see that different people reached different targets according to what they did. One of the best parts, one of the worst places was USA, and one of the best thing was South Korea, which has 470 deaths up to now. The Taiwan, Singapore, the Norway. So these are some of the countries which had the best results that they could do it. So now I will go to the bovine TB. India is one of the biggest milk producing country, has the largest animal cattle group over here. We have enriched the South American cattle group from our Andhra cattle, which were imported in Brazil. But we have the largest number of sick animals over here suffering from bovine tuberculosis, which actually passes from different animal species with the bovine, like the tigers also have, the lions in Africa have. So those who eat these animals, they also get it. So our problem is that about 50 years back, most of the developed countries have got rid of the bovine tuberculosis, because what they did, they took the economic aspect of this very seriously, and they cull the cattle if they get the tuberculosis, and they compensate the farmers. So they have controlled it. At that time, there was no vaccine. Now there is a vaccine to this. And for the Johns bacillus, which is a paratuberculosis, I was involved in the creating the vaccine for Johns bacillus, which is now being being made by the BioVet. The Johns bacillus, the New Zealand and Australia, etc., they actually eliminated that through the vaccination. So this is, but in India, if you want to cull a cow, you get ready to get culled yourself. So they are now all actually concentrated in goshalas and very high rate of infection between and animals. So about 5 to 10% of all human tuberculosis is caused by bovis. They can affect lymph nodes, skin, bones, joint, genital urinary system, cervical lymphadenopathy, scrofula in children, lupus vulgaris, Boucher's wart, pulmonary TB, and treatable disease, extra pulmonary tuberculosis. And this is something which is a cycle, which is over there. And human behavior is one of the, sorry. Human behavior is one of the things which is responsible for this. So one of the things which we needed if we wanted to give a vaccine. So we decided with Penn University, Vivek Kapoor, I was part of this. We got the Bill Melinda Gates Foundation funding that in Africa and in India, we will use BCG vaccination for this. If you know what is BCG vaccine, it is a bovine tuberculosis bacteria which was found from a cow's udder, like the one which was for the vaccinia one from the smallpox. So this cow's udder thing got about in the Pasteur Institute. It was about 325 passages, and one major about 5 kilo Dalton area was deleted out of that, and that made it very, very stable, non-infective, but non-pathogenic organism. So this was used in the humans at one time. In India, it failed, but it was still good for the young children and others. But we thought that why don't we use it for cattle? The major problem came that how do you diagnose an infected animal from a vaccinated animal? Because if you can't, then whom do you vaccinate? Only you vaccinate new herds, you cannot vaccinate others. So a defined antigen, there were one, like there was a PPDA, PPDB, and a mixture of PPDA and PPDB, which was used at the neck of the cattle to do the skin test. And if it was more than 8 millimeters or 10 millimeters, it was infected. Otherwise, they had an experience. In human, it is 16 millimeter. But then there was a need to create a defined antigen. And this defined antigen created a DIVA-like, This created a DIVA-like product. DIVA is that which will diagnose infection from vaccine. So this is the dendrogram. Sorry, I can't handle it properly. This is the dendrogram of the there's a complete full sequence. The huge number of microbiota, about 2,000 of them got sequenced, including bovine tuberculosis. I will not go into the details of this, but if you see this, this is how the mycobacterium tuberculosis has differentiated. India has Delhi and Eastern African type. Now we have a lot of Beijing type over here. And these are the M. bovis strains which have got separated. The problem is that now there is very little M. bovis in cattle. It is M. origis in the cattle. M. origis comes into an entirely different cluster over here. So this is the problem at this given moment over here. So if we look at the isolates of subspecies determination, the Mycobacterium origis is about 1.5% extrapulmonary, 0.2%. what is given for Mycobacterium bovis is not correct. It is 0.3% at this given moment. This is an old slide, but recently it was found a non-tubercular bacteria also there. So if we really now have a protection program, this has to be done for taking into account the M origis, because if we don't do M origis, there will be an issue. So now what happened, if we look at the antigens, this defined antigen was didn't really detect any vaccinated individual. It detected in the control and others, but it didn't detect in the vaccinated animals. This is a very good example of this. The PPD A, PPD B, this is the DST, and if you see that the defined antigen didn't have any in the controls, it didn't detect. And if we took vaccinated animals, we could see that in the vaccinated animals, it really didn't detect anything. And so another area was created, skin test, which was not simple DST, which actually created two areas which were chosen. It was a chimeric antigen area, and chimeric antigen area, this is a PPDA, PPDB. The chimeric antigen area was known as PCL and PC1. One was a long chain chimeric, other one was a short chain chimeric. But short chain chimeric worked much better. So we have now in the vaccinated and unvaccinated person, we have now an antigen which will define it. So we are now with this, we are now in, immunizing. There's a heat map. The above one was the upper one was a long chain thing, lower one was a short chain one. You said a lot of green in this heat map. So we are now vaccinating these cattle and looking at that what will be the predictor for these cattle breeds. And the study is on. So we do not have at the moment the data for that, but this is the data around India, that how these bovine tuberculosis is spread into different states. And so now I come to, so there is a program which will, we don't have any other method. This is the method in which we intend to control bovine tuberculosis. One of the problem which comes is, now we have Mycobacterium origis. We do not know how to handle Mycobacterium origis. We don't get it from the milk that much, because in India, the culturally we boil our milk. Nobody else in the world they don't boil pasteurized milk. So if you go to a hotel anywhere, they will give you the cold pasteurized milk with your tea or coffee. In India, we boil it. So perhaps that is not the area in which we get it. We get a lot of skin and other effects through contact, through genitourinary secretions, other secretions. So we need to have real good public health interventions to control this. Now, brucellosis is another very big infection which is there. And if you see that infection rate is very high in the brucellosis, the last one. It also cut across lot of animal species. Different species do the suis, then canis. Abortus is one of the ones which is important for us. Brucella melitensis, which happens in the goats, is also, and this is very high pathogenicity. And this is the spread of the disease. This is the method in which the disease spreads. It also has separated, but not that big. So it is very, perhaps the vaccination will work. And we had a attenuated bison strain vaccine in India, which was being used by the IVRI and others for the brucellosis. But this particular one was not that nice, and it really didn't work that well. And you see that it didn't have advantage of these kind of antigen domain when you design the vaccine. So now we have and if you really look at the functional component, it almost affects the entire metabolic system in our body. If you really do the bioinformatics from the genomics of this. So, and there is no good diagnostic. You see that how the IgG, IgM spreads over here. At the moment, whatever diagnostics we have a PCR also, but it is not a very ideal diagnostic test like this typhoid. And you go from, if you are vaccinated, you go from susceptible to infected to immune compartment. So vaccination still remains a very important part. And this is one of the vaccine studies, and we can see the impact of the vaccine study that really with the different kinds of vaccine and different doses, you ultimately reach the plateau. So this is one of the new vaccine which has developed. This is a xyloglucan-based mucosal nanovaccine. This comes from the tamarind, like chitosan. This nanoparticle comes from the tamarind, and it is against the lipopolysaccharide portion of actually engineered lipopolysaccharide portion of the brucellosis. And there is a machine through which it is delivered. And if we see that that it actually works quite well. And so this is the vaccine which at the moment we have this. There is another one which is known as Brucella abortus S19 first strain, where a deletion has been affected, and IVRI has given this particular vaccine into the population now. So this is being manufactured and has gone to population. This is one very sad story. Anthrax is another one health arena which actually affects us. In India, it is rampant in Odisha, particularly the hilly and tribal area states, Andhra, Tamil Nadu, West Bengal. This is the belt where this is, and this has got various genotype. In India, hardly genotyping occurred because people have neglected it. And our animals were vaccinated by that inverted strain, either the Stern strain or the Vellum strain. These are the two strains which are used for vaccinating anthrax, but not a very effective and good vaccine, and had a different kind of results out of this. So this is the belt where this is spread. So there are two kinds of therapies. These are the areas where this is rampant. This is the part where it is there. So the molecular calculation is also very, very easy.
There
are different
clusters. But apparently he is a desert. So there is some payment to be done.
And
so
this is the cluster.
I will just send her to you. How much is the charge?
And the endogram again do not show too much of a variation, but different strains from the different countries show little bit of differences. So that this one, there are a lot of interventions over here.
And one of the interventions is
monoclonal antibodies or other antibodies. So that is a very powerful tool.
I just asked her to be. You are up there in
India, actually, imported some. And this was very good and effective. But Indians did not use it. So their whole stock was destroyed. But because the price was too high, it was higher than the price of a cattle, which has got anthrax. So Bhatnagar et al. There was a vaccine in Walter Reed. So he was working in the Walter Reed. Problem is that the anthrax has got four major areas. One is it has got two plasmids. So if you really sequence anthrax, you have to take care of that. Cholera has two, and Jyotirmay Das got, he did the first sequencing of a human pathogen with Partha Majumdar, and he published it and later on found that Honda has described two chromosomes and anthrax has a similar one, 4-1 and 4-2. And it has got a protective antigen that actually is cleaved by one of the proteases so that the lethal toxin and edema toxin, both of them, which are the lethal part, enters from there. So a lot of people try to do a protective antigen vaccine, but it is notoriously labile. So you cannot really do it. In rabies also, the G protein vaccine could not be made. Only Cadila has recently made it through a VLP template so that it was stabilized. So Bhatnagar, etc., were able to stabilize it, and they created a construct which has one area from here, protective antigen, which is known as ID, and from the LF and from the LF as well as LF as well as the EF, they picked up LFN and they created a chimeric part, and this they used an adjuvant, saponin-based adjuvant, and immunized mice and showed very nice protection in mice. This particular thing went to Panacea. Panacea purchased it. They gave them 1 crore of rupees, but ultimately Panacea didn't use it in the population because they found that there were not enough policy at the moment to use anthrax, this kind of anthrax vaccine, even in the animal population, what to call about human population. So this vaccine is lying at this moment, is not being used here, even though it was produced and the investigators got more than 1 crore rupees as it. So this is the sad story of plague in Gujarat after the earthquake and Maharashtra. So there was a first, it started in Bid and Latur. It has a bubonic plague. So people left the village in Bid and Latur, stored their grain in their houses and went away. So what happened there, that these Rattus and Rattus norvegicus, these two are the, there is a group in India, very small group, which are known as mammalogists. Mammalogists are the people who study rats. And so we then went to a mammalogist because we wanted to know more about that, because Rattus were house rats. How did they get plague? So what happened, the mammalogist then went and found there was a feral rat which is known as Bandicoota bengalensis. Now this Bandicoota bengalensis mixed with the feral rat and passed on the plague bacillus to them. We used to have plague when we were children, we had plague in India, and West Bengal and other, which were very heavily infested areas, had tremendous infrastructure, particular school of tropical disease. Now what we got into a problem, that there was a group, I will not name the scientists, they said it was a melidiosis. So it was Pseudomallei, which is causing the infection. So when we went to look at it, and we found that this was a soil Pseudomonas, which was known as Pseudomonas sulzerai. So Pseudomonas sulzerai is a soil. It was not, so they went to town that it was not plague. And Mei Chu, who came from the CDC, they threw them back. So we started looking at that, who understands plague in India. So somehow or other, we found out one plague person in India. His name was Dr. Batra. He was in the DRDO, Bhopal. So we provided him a BSL-3, and we then Dr. Batra then created a diagnostic, and these diagnostics were then used. So, but by this time, these Latur Bid guys went to a religious function in Surat, and an outbreak broke down in Surat, and 61 person died with a pneumonic plague. Pneumonic plague is very, very dangerous. So this is how this spread. This, it is not that it remained in Surat and other, it spread to other parts of the world, and it also spread to other part of India. And so these were our diagnostic. Apart from the typical colony, we had a bacteriophage lysis, we have an F1 staining, and we also had a PCR. So PCR we was held with Dr. Amit Ghosh in the Institute of Microbial Technology. We took care of, we took part, found out anyone who will help us. So Dr. Amit Ghosh did the fingerprinting. And when he did the fingerprinting, then somebody told us that, well, actually went to the media that this is Pakistani guys who have put this stain in India. So this was a huge problem for us. We didn't have any repository of plague bacillus in India. So we had to go to Pasteur Institute and CDC to get plague bacillus from there. And this was a clonal strain. So nobody actually, this was a wild clonal strain which was infecting us. So at that time, we lost $7 billion in 1 week. Nobody will buy anything from us. That was the first time the planes were not flying into India and they were not allowed to go from India outside. That was the first time when this in the world before SARS came, this kind of restriction came up. So this was the misery. At that time, 13 other countries were having plague bacillus. They were not affected, including a part of United States. So we published it in Nature. So this I will be very quick because I do not have too much time. Leptospirosis is a huge number of species. Leptospira icterohemorrhagae, autumnalis, canicola, huge number of species. These are endemic in India, particularly the Andaman Nicobar Island. They cause a lot of outbreaks over there. And there is a good diagnostic test which have been developed in India, also in the Netherlands Tropical Institute. There is also a vaccine to this, but it goes on visiting us from time to time. In the southern India, Gujarat, Maharashtra, this is endemic. And this is the Bombay flood. I was called by Dr. Deshmukh there. I'm only showing those one where I was involved somehow, that find out a solution. We found out of the 12 deaths, we found three of them, which were leptospirosis infection. So these are all the strains which are there. And there are major reservoirs which are in the animals, and there are preliminary reservoirs which are in the animals and humans. So essentially the rat is the main thing over here. And this causes a huge number of things, right from anaphylaxis to kidney to conjunctivitis, fever. So large number of symptoms actually occur over here. So I moved from there is a vaccine to Leptospira, a common vaccine with a common, because it's very difficult. There are about 15 different species and there are a lot of strains which occur. So it is very difficult that you create effective vaccines to all of them. In India, India is not using the vaccine at this moment. Actually, nobody in the world is using the vaccine, although the vaccine trials were conducted successfully. So because there is some chronicity which comes up, there are some issues, safety issues in this. So this is an area which we should go on taking it up. Salmonella typhimurium is another one, antimicrobial resistance. I will just briefly touch it, because what happens that in world, there are grazing land where the cattle graze. And then there are human habitations. In India, the free-ranging cattle and us live together. Sometimes they sleep in the same room. And then the antibiotic usage is in cattle is much higher than human. And agricultural use of antibiotic, like the molasses or those who make sugar, because a lot of lactobacillus gets into around the vat. And the best way is to kill them with antibiotic. That is what people do. So agricultural practices, animal practices, are totally bad. So we created a thinking, and animal surveillance was not there in Euro surveillance, Euro other. There are surveillance systems which are there. There are diagnostic method which you could take to the even periphery and in the villages to find out antibiotic resistant these bugs. So one of the major arena in the antibiotic resistance from animal to human is Salmonella. There is one horrendous Salmonella typhi, Salmonella 58, strain 58, which is ravaging Pakistan and many areas around the world. And this Salmonella typhimurium is also something which, if you see that how it has peaked, the animal in the meat and in the human at the same time, it has peaked. So now I come to some of the viruses very quickly. So one of the things which hit us was SARS, not this COVID-19, the SARS-CoV. This happened again from China, from bat to civet to humans, and very rapidly it spread. Somehow or other, India was spared. It spread to Europe. It spread to other Southeast Asian region. It spread to North America, Canada. And Southern America was spared, Australia was spared. And India, we had only one case who came from Bangalore. We got a lot of non-confirmed susceptible strains. At that time, I told several things about this. I told that there are asymptomatic cases because I found SARS coronavirus in the urine sample and the stool sample. It attacks the gastrointestinal tract very quickly. And because there it destroys the immune system, as the HIV virus also does. So nobody listened to me. And I said also that, but now we know that what asymptomatics can do. I also said that N95 mask is not fully protective. At that time, N95 mask also came up. But again, I was asked to shut up. They said, no, you will create a panic, so don't talk about this. But all of these are coming true at this given moment. So this was, I was asking that, do you have a cryo electron microscope? So this is this was seen by Atanu Basu in the NIV, who had at that time a cryo electron microscope. And he also found out another very interesting virus, which is known as Gumburo virus. You know, our bats population is vanishing, and bat population is a very important scavenger in our part of the world, because they scavenge animal carcasses, many things. So bats are very essential. The Parsis, if the bats are not there, they can lead to tremendous problem, because the bats have to eat their bodies of a Parsi. So bats were dying from the diclofenac, which was given for cattle arthritis. But bat was also dying with the Gumburo virus, which came from Pakistan to India because of the export of the birds. And ultimately, this affected the kidneys. So this was also seen through a cryo-electron microscope. So I advise your microscopists to buy one cryo-electron microscope. Although there are now viral chips which can look at the new virus cell, the cryo-electron microscope, one of the easiest tests to screen for the new virus. So anyway, there's the Middle East. We created a vaccine for the SARS, not India, but several of the major vaccine companies created, but SARS vanished and nobody bothered about it. All the efforts died and vaccine, but those platforms remain. Some of them are being used for COVID now. But MERS was something which is still moving. This was from the camel, and the some of the strains were from Saudi Arabia, Jordan, and now in the Korea and South Korea. Now this virus, they gave a little bit of new arena of the animal milk. You know, the cow colostrum is very good, and human colostrum is also very good. So it protects. So the one of the population in Rajasthan, which is known as Raika population, even the Saudi Arabians and Middle East people don't drink camel milk anymore. They drink human milk. But Raika population drinks camel milk. And camel milk have peptides. These are antibody-like molecules which have several arms like monsters, and they have insulin-like properties, and they don't have diabetes. Around them, those who are drinking normal milk, they have diabetes. But here now for COVID, something came up. These peptides in the camel milk, and in the South America, there is an animal known as llama. In llama's milk, you get these peptides, and these peptides neutralize viruses. So this is something which this is the relationship of the human and other. MERS virus has separated. And do you know, the world's one of the major MERS virus vaccine is being manufactured in India and being exported. This is being done by the CPL Biologics, which is a Cadila thing with the Novavax. So they, because the vaccine cost was being hampered if they were manufactured in United States, so this is being manufactured here and Spain. So this vaccine is available. Now here I was really in the midst of things. For the avian influenza in the Nawapur, in the Maharashtra. And people actually, the culling was happening. Farmers were becoming very poor because they were not compensating enough for. So the birds were flying illegally to other places, very difficult to control. But the diagnostics were put up very, very quickly. And this is from the bird. If you look, we isolated from trachea, lungs, and brain. Everywhere in the birds it was there. And the NP gene, which dissociated, was one of the major things. So here it is very interesting. You see that several strains were circulating at a different part of India. And in India, and this was from wild bird to the local bird. In India, this was clade 2.2. And it was from the Qinghai Lake from China, then Russia, Siberia, Iran, Turkey, and India. This is the clade 2.2. So this is the Indian clade, this 2.2 clade. And we did a lot of studies in this and find out that glycosylation is very important for this, for human to bird transmission. And somehow or other, ours was very inefficient in human to bird transmission. But ultimately, in Indonesia, we encountered the real method of spreading, which is now important for COVID. It was the wet markets where the ducks do not suffer that much, birds suffer. So in the wet market, the ducks and the chicken were piled there, and real spread happened from the wet markets, not from the animal farm. So this particular mode of transmission was found out. The strains were again sequenced, like H1N1 California was sequenced in few days, and they put it in the web. These times they were not putting it. We had a problem in West Bengal. It is an area of a duck and chicken together, and some of the guys, they take duck egg, they don't take chicken egg, because they think duck is much purer bird. So the duck is not only meat, it is thriving there. So this is a deadly combination. So these two happened there. And so the culling government was not giving price. So all Indian birds and from Assam and West Bengal flew it to Bangladesh. Bangladesh has a severe outbreak. We wanted to have a sequence from Bangladeshi strain. Now this is not a issue, but at that time this was an issue. So we established, I was one of the major founder member of GISAID, GISAID is one of the organizations which was in the Swiss School of Medicine, Geneva, and Basel School. One was a proteomics and one was a genomic center. And we then started getting, and in the COVID area, GISAID has become a very important source of the sequence information globally. So this was very important, sharing of the data and a data bank for the animal health is very, very important to protect our interest. So I will not talk about H1N1. There's a lot of things to talk about H1N1, but it didn't happen in my time. I had retired from that time. Later on, I was involved in some of the H1N1 arena, but I will not talk about that today because I'm only touching areas where I had a diet. So H7N9 also occurred. It came to India, it came to Netherlands, Europe and others, but disappeared. So India was really lucky. It has a very small sojourn over here. But H1N1 has a very strong relationship in the pigs. And it was like the French virus, which came in the 1918 French influenza, which wiped out a huge number of human population around the globe. We should have learned from that time. We didn't learn. So we need to really now, human respiratory viruses, which have incubation in animals, we need to learn from them. And we need to really be prepared. We are preparing, but I don't know how long we will prepare. This is from Andhra, this area, Telangana also. There was a JE infection over here. So JE is by the Culex Vishnui and the birds and human. So at that time, Mr. Chandrababu Naidu used JE vaccine very widely over here. So JE disappeared, but in the animal world, no space is left. So suddenly there was another vector from the Strongimia species. The Strongimia species harbored Chandipura virus. Why repositories are important? That we found that the case fatality rate was much higher than the JE. And the encephalopathies were much higher over here. And the population which was affected was a different population. So we thought it is not JE, and it was actually not JE. So we, in 1965, Dr. Rodericks has identified it in Chandipura area in near Nagpur, and she saved the strain. So this strain ultimately came very handy to us, and this is actually a rhabdovirus. This is not a flavivirus, and we developed a lot of tests, indigenous tests at that time. With this, apart from the tissue culture, we had a G protein identification over here. We have an IFA chip, and we but this has become endemic in India now. This is in a wide area. At this given moment, the Bharat Biotech has a program to make vaccine to Chandipura virus, but we do not know whether, because it is not having outbreak, it is endemic, causing small infections, but not enough to warrant a real vaccine. So the Japanese encephalitis, I was actually involved. This was in my city, about 11,000 children died, and we were put in a tremendous pressure that deal with it. So at that time, the Nakayama strain, which was vaccine, was being made in Kasauli. They didn't have an animal house. Their animal house has vanished. So they couldn't make the vaccine. We tried to buy it from Thais. Thais didn't give us the vaccine. So Bill Gates' father rammed down the Chinese-Japanese encephalitis vaccine on us. And when we immunized them, we found that Chinese had not even done animal toxicology. They went to human directly, millions of millions of humans. So when I studied, I found that in Koreans, this was an attenuated strain. It was found in South Korea in the mosquitoes. So there was a problem of reassortment over there. This caused a lot of respiratory infection in the Koreans. In India, a lot of children died because of the fever, convulsion, respiratory infection, and other. But we gave it in any case. We didn't have a print. So assays are very important. So please set up an assay lab over here. The print assay was not there at that time. We got ultimately settled it and found that in 45, in around less than 6 months, 45% didn't have this antibody. So at this given moment, so the NIV did an in-house one, but then Khanna from the ICGB has made a very good kit with J. Mitra now market. So kit is available, which has the NSPs, antigens, as well as the other ORFs over here. But this chart I am showing that now the Gorakhpur strain has deviated a lot from here. And this particular vaccine at this given moment, the Thai strain, which has now entered India, this vaccine now doesn't really protect from the Thai infection. So the sequencing and finding out information is very, very important. So now the Bharat Biotech has made a vaccine. The BioE has made the vaccine. Sudhanshu Brati also made a vaccine, but it didn't flow. Acambis, which now was purchased by Sanofi, had a vaccine. I tried to do it. It has a yellow fever shell. We tried to move it, but it really didn't move. So I am not dealing with the flaviviruses. Flavivirus is another thing which is a real misery. In South America, all of them are there. Dengue is there, Zika is there, the yellow fever is there, the West Nile is there, all the J is there, all the flaviviruses are there. There's a mess. In India, why we don't have a the yellow fever, we don't know. So one of the things which came up that Indian mosquitoes, Aedes, is not very efficient in moving this. So what we did, there is a guy known as Douglas Dugan. Douglas Dugan is a very good vector biologist. So Dugan has done work in monkeys with the yellow fever in America. And he found out the Ceylonese Aedes is one of the most efficient Aedes to spread yellow fever. So that theory went. So most of the theory is this, that our immunologic matrix is so complex in our place. Although we have the monkey, although we have everything, it really doesn't affect. But the problem with the flavivirus is this, they do disease enhancing antibodies. So dengue, again, Khanna and Subramaniam from ICGB has given one vaccine to Sun Pharma. Takeda's vaccine has become successful. Sanofi's really whimpered and created a lot of damage because Philippines used it. But it could be only given from 9 onwards. Takeda's vaccine could be given and it is now published in Lancet. But Sun Pharma thing doesn't give disease enhancing antibodies. For COVID, it is important. The disease enhancing antibodies, inflammatory system and others are important. Today, I will not be talking too much about COVID because I gave a lecture in NII Foundation Day, but I will give you a little bit of flavor. But I talked about the flaviviruses because it is one of the biggest misery in flaviviruses which India might face, but it was too big a subject. I just give you a flavor. Chikungunya, I was summoned in Kerala Assembly and was given the biggest dhulai I ever got in my life ever. Because they said, we don't know anything, you understand. The same thing when Krishna went and Sudama went to Gopi Krishna. Said, we don't know anything. We don't understand anything. We are missing him, so bring him here. So the same thing happened to me. And this was, so that was a harbinger of setting up. I got to Gallo and Hall and others. And now we have set up a Institute of Virology in Trivandrum. And I'm the chairman of that and in the governing body. But this is a misery in the way that that it also in those who have a metabolic disorder or secondary morbidity, it causes death in them, but doesn't cause too much death, but it causes bone thing, like the same long hauler that if you get it, you can't really get up and walk. There's so much arthritis with the chikungunya. But chikungunya vaccine has now been made the vaccine was not really flying. French had made it much earlier for the Independence Island and others. But it used to visit every 20 years or every 30 years. Nobody bothered. Now, somehow or other, it is visiting much more often. So Bharat Biotech has a vaccine which is going through second phase and will perhaps. So this actually, again, diverts. Somewhere the mutation is happened. And this is a Congo mutation which happened and came to India. So it is very important to have repositories. There's the same thing. These are the Nagpur strains, which we could get to other place of the Asia, and the origin is a mutation which happened in Congo. This is something which is the first viral vaccine and new virus which was identified in India. This happened in Kyasanur forest. This is between a monkey and between a rodent and humans. It happened because of deforestation, one of the major things which we have talked about, deforestation. So the huge number of people died. So the NIV actually created a vaccine. This vaccine is still being used in the Karnataka. And there is a vaccine company, animal vaccine company in Bangalore. Anyone you get, you please visit that. It creates beautiful animal vaccines in India, one of the very high class vaccines in India, supported by Karnataka government. I never knew it existed, but I went with Vivek Kapoor there. So this was an inactivated embryo tissue culture vaccine, but now appropriate vaccine is being developed. And the problem is this, that Kyasanur forest disease has now spread. So, and we couldn't do it. So I actually attended that meeting. There is a environment group in UK known as the Institute of Hydrology and Ecology. So hydrology and ecology guys have now mapped it, that how it is spreading, how it is going to Kerala, how it is going to Goa and others, how it is going to other part of Maharashtra and Karnataka. And they have now mapped the whole thing and how it is spreading. And so it is so beautiful that you should, if you are an animal group, you must have an environment group over here. You can't do without it. And you need to have a repository. If you don't have repository, you can't do without it. And you should have several Nova-6 over here, apart from your bioinformatic power, so that you could do complete sequencing and annotation of viruses very quickly. Because you are doing with the cattle as well as bacteria. So this is the COVID-19 pandemic. I will not, you are absolutely, but we are actually competing with US. Okay, at the moment we are dipping somewhere or other because we are wearing masks. Africans are not wearing masks. So somewhere or other we are little better, but our death rate is little lower. Shekhar Mande just published a paper, you read the hypothesis. I'm not going to talk about that just now. So this is one, when I was talking on Novasig, this was a Vinod Skaria and other. Now about 4 DBT labs are doing it. We have I actually chair the DBT repository committee, and now 5 repositories for the COVID has been established. But Vinod and others did the first Novasig thing, about four batches they did, and then they sequenced it. And so they could do 300, 1,500, and 3,000. And this actually, a lot of theories flew with this, that whether the Wuhan was a genetical engineering thing or not, whether bat is the origin or not, because both fruit bat and other bats got the viruses got sequenced in India. But what happened that they could jump it because there is a protease in the new COVID vaccine, the furan kind of protease, which actually separates one from the spike protein 2, so that it can also internalize through other mechanisms, that just not only because of the ACE receptor. So so up to now, no evidence moves towards that. But one of our new Nobel laureates said that we haven't seen any virus which will grow in any climate, any nation, everywhere. But French flu did that. So one people remind that he has retracted this. So they created a tree, and they created how this actually moves around India. And so there are now this variant. India has 8 clades, G, G, H, L, S, V, and some are a little less pathogenic than the others. But the main clades which are happening in India at the moment is the A2A. It has replaced the previous one. Previous one was A31, now it is A2A. But this is a story which I collaborated with India with one of the repositories which is done by ZIFO. I sometimes advise them. This is a Chennai based organization. So this was there is a guy in Oregon. What happened? There was a guy in Oregon. He's an Indian guy. So with the ZIFO, we started sequencing our strains over here. But here, when they have done it, you can find that they also have got all the kids, G, G, H, S, L, V. All the strains they have. But what they found out from this, that they could actually, you know, here they are concentrating over here. So they found out that a person who goes to ICU, they can predict. A person who goes to ventilator, they could predict. But what they could do, they could do the cluster mapping. You see that each of these which have a strain, they really found out, and they could now see that how these have clustered and how you could create systems which will protect it. This happened in Andhra and Tamil Nadu. The Tamil Nadu has one of the best public health systems in our country. So what they did both in Andhra and Tamil Nadu, this paper has come in Science. And they tracked 84,000 cases. They tracked 3,50,000 people. And they identified that it has not only gone to rural India, it also has infection rate is very, death rate is very high, although overall infection rate is less because they're such a huge country. You take children,